I'm going to start reading another great Upanishad called Chandogya. The Upanishads really form the cradle of our civilization. It is not politically oriented, economically oriented, even culturally oriented. It is essentially spiritually oriented. And there have been many times during the last 5,000 years when it has gone astray, causing great insecurity, great turmoil, so that the people began to long for a divine incarnation who would come, live in their midst, and restore the direction. This has happened so many times in our checkered history that I, for one, have great faith. Even today, when I see very upsetting events taking place in India, because I know from my personal experience that when millions of people deeply long for a restoration of direction, human beings get inspired. And Mahatma Gandhi, from whose life I've been illustrating this truth, puts it very simply when he says, when your self-will has been extinguished and you realize your identity with all countries, all races, all people, and all animals and birds, then the power of God rises in you and uses you as a humble instrument to bring people back so that they can again keep their eyes on the goal of life. So, I'm going to read the Chandogya Upanishad from my own translation, beginning with the great story of Shvetaketu. Shvetaketu was Uddalaka's son. When he was 12, his father said to him, "It's time for you to find a teacher, dear one, for no one in our family is a stranger to the spiritual life." That gives the secret of our ancient civilization, that it was not enough if you had a beautiful house, a caparison elephant, all the material comforts of life. Until and unless there was somebody in your family taking to the spiritual life and showing all the other members of the family that it is in contributing to life that you grow to your full status, It is in giving to all those around you that you become secure, and it is in extinguishing your self-will that you really become beautiful. So, Shvetaketu was Uddalaka's son. I like the story and the lines very, very much. When he was 12, his father said to him, would you like to go on a picnic? Would you like to learn to drive a car? He says, it's time for you to find a teacher. And this is the greatest gift in our civilization. When, as in the case of Ramdas, his father was his teacher. In the case of Gandhiji, his mother was his teacher. In my case, it is my grandmother. So we don't have to go outside. We don't have to go to another person outside the family even, because this is the greatest gift that every human being can give to the children. When this takes place, it is a gift to the country. It's a gift to the community, because these people will act as stabilizing influences when waves of agitation and turmoil sweep over the country. 2 days ago, I was walking with some friends in Armstrong Redwood Park. I haven't been there for many years, and I was astonished at those trees. The more I looked at them, the more I came to love them. And it was all still. Unlike our tropical forests, where elephants trumpet, tigers roar, there are lots of very variegated sounds. Here everything was still, partly it was the time in the evening, and I enjoyed the silence so much that I was walking about, I couldn't hear even the twittering of a bird. I think it's one of the English poets, probably John Keats, who says, does anybody remember the line? It'll come back to me. And I thought that would be a perfect simile for the silence of the mind. When all personal conflicts are resolved, when all selfish desires come to rest, the silence is internal, but externally it is a good simile. I walked about and tried to look at those giant trees, some of them 1,000 years old. And that's how I see our sages, as giant brown wood trees, towering so high that there can be no agitation in their society. There can be no turmoil in their neighborhood. That's why I really hope our children, after going through the natural vicissitudes of college life, will become like these trees and enable people to live in security, in selfless service. In Kerala state, we have millions of banana trees. And if you notice a banana tree, you will always have a few little banana trees around them. And my mother tongue is very good for this. She says, calves. The banana tree is the big cow. And you get a number of calves around the big cow. And that's how I saw the redwood tree. Around a huge redwood tree, there were a number of little redwood calves. And they will slowly grow to become redwood trees. This is why, if a person practices meditation regularly, sincerely, with sustained enthusiasm, and follows the disciplines to the extent of their capacity, I have very little doubt that the children and the children's children will become very beneficial influences in life, in their community and their country. So Shvetaketu went to a teacher and studied all the Vedas for 12 years. At the end of this time, he returned home, graduated, proud of his intellectual knowledge, just as out from our universities, you know. So the father looked at him. "You seem to be proud of all this learning," said Uttalaka. "But did you ask your teacher for that spiritual wisdom which enables you to hear the unheard, to think the unthought, and to know the unknown?" "What is this wisdom, father?" asked the son. He never heard about it. He had never heard about it in 132, of course. He never heard about all this. And look at the answer. Uddalaka said to Shvetaketu, he becomes his son's teacher. So our fathers can become their children's teacher. Our mothers can become their children's teacher. If you love enough, if you care enough. Uddalaka said to Shvetaketu, "As by knowing one lump of clay, dear one, we come to know all things made out of clay, pots and pans and plates, that they differ only in name and form, but they are all made of clay, while the stuff of which all are made is clay." See, if how the awareness comes to us is that all people have the Atman in them, and the very thought of declaring war against other countries becomes impossible. That is why Ashoka renounced war in the hour of victory. The thought of exploiting third world countries becomes impossible for us. The thought of apartheid, of racism, all these become absolutely impossible for us, because now we realize that the self is in all of us. When we often see the mass media depriving the opponents of humanity. That's one of the great strategies that people have always followed for declaring war, and we see strategy being followed by the mass media, and it's very easy for us to remember that in all countries, families love to live long. In all countries, parents don't want their young people to die. In all countries, everybody wants their food. Everybody wants their medical care. If we remember all this deeply, then nobody would ever want to declare war or party to be a war. "As by knowing one gold nugget, dear one, we come to know all things made of gold, that they differ only in name and form, while the stuff of which all are made is gold. Now, look at all the gold ornaments that we see here. They look different in shape. Necklace, earring, nose ring in India. But they're all made of gold, only in different shapes and sizes. That's why people may be white, people may be black, people may be brown, people may be tall, short. They may be from the Western Hemisphere, Eastern Hemisphere, North or South. You always will know these are all one. We cannot dream of hurting them. We cannot dream of harming them under any circumstances. So through that spiritual wisdom, dear one, we come to know that all of life is one. That's how we respect the environment, respect world peace, contribute to protect the environment, contribute to world peace. My teachers must not have known this wisdom. See, the boy is surprised. I never heard this in any college seminar. My teachers must not have known this wisdom, said Shvetaketu. For if they had known, how could they have failed to teach this to me? He's being very nice about his teachers, you know. Father, see, this is a great climax. Father, please instruct me in this wisdom. And this is how the son inherits the greatest legacy of the parents' wisdom. And I have very little doubt, even here, we are going to hear from our young people at the right time. How do we meditate? How do we train the mind? Yes, dear one, I will, replied his father, who have been waiting for this moment, who is playing it cool, as you say. In the beginning was only being. One without a second. God alone was there. There was no one else. Advaita, no second. Out of himself, he brought forth the cosmos. And the simile given in the Upanishads is beautiful. As the spider spins the web out of itself, and the Sanskrit genius, Urna Nabhi. The name for the spider is Nabhi, navel. Urna has a lot of thread in it. Just see the beauty of the language, you see. Urna. And just as the spider will spin the web beautifully, in the beginning was only being, one without a second. Out of himself he brought forth the cosmos and entered into everything in it. Into Helen, into Robbie, into Stuart, into Sarah, in everybody. He entered into it. And this is a refrain. It has become part of my deepest consciousness. There is nothing that does not come from God. Of everything, He is the inmost self. He is the truth. He is the Self Supreme. You are that, Shvetaketu. You are that. Now I'll try to give you a little taste of the Sanskrit dialogue between Uddalaka and Shvetaketu. the way the father addresses the son is beautiful beyond words. Saumya. See, the father has seen into the heart of the boy, the doors of which have opened wide to receive this priceless legacy, which in my own small life I have received from my grandmother, helped by my mother, helped by my father, helped by my grandfather, my aunt, my uncle. So Saumya means gentle one. See, that is the ideal source of strength. It's a combination of tenderness and toughness. And people who try to harm others, hurt others, exploit others, retaliate against others for imagined wrongs, they're all without any kind of real strength. And that is why I call Gandhi the strongest man of the 20th century. Weighed less than 100 pounds. Was worth less than $5 in material possessions. Saumya means gentle. Saumya also means good. And this kind of goodness is an all-pervasive force. Saumya, yatha, just as. Saumya, gentle, good, sweet boy. Gandharebhyo, from the state of Gandhara, abhinaddhaksham, blindfolded. Aniya, a person from Gandhara has been brought blindfolded and left in a lonely place. Blindfolded, not knowing the direction, feeling lost, without anybody to help, and panicking, running hither and thither in search of a way home, shouting, screaming, I'm lost. I don't know the way home. Pratmayadabhi naddhaksha, my eyes are bandaged. I've been brought here blindfolded, abhinaddhascho visrashtaha, and I've been abandoned with nobody to help to. It's very much the story of the Buddha. His message, we're all walking blindfold. That's our posture in life. And because we are blindfolded and we don't know we are blindfolded, we pick up anything that our fingers touch. Ridiculous material possessions. And it's a very pictorial comment on how much of the damage done to the environment, how much of the fierce outbreaks of violence between nations, blindfolded. That's why it's one of the greatest Upanishads, where we're all picking up anything that our fingers touch because we cannot see. We don't know what its worth is. We don't know whether it will answer our needs. And that's a very grim comment on most of the frenzied consumerism that is going on in our modern civilization. Tasya yathabihinahanam pramuchya prabhuyat. And when such a person running here and there, not knowing the way home, we are all wanting to go home, which means reach a state of being comfortable in the world, reach a state of being able to contribute a little to the world. This is what everybody is running about. Yathabhinahinam pramuchya prabhuyat. Supposing such a person meets a good man or a good woman who hears the cry, runs to the blind person's help, prabhuyat. Look at the beauty of the simile. Etam disham gandhara. You're just running round and round. You're going round and round in the same ditch. That etam disha, in that direction lies gandhara, your home. Etam disham vrajeti. So instead of screaming and shouting and running round and round, why don't you just go home? I remember reading an old story when I was teaching at the university, which my freshmen liked very much. A person imprisoned for life, cursing fate, cursing destiny. One day, a friend comes in and he says, how did you get in? There's a door. Isn't it closed? No, it's open. That's our story. The door is open. We don't know where the door is. And in the Upanishads, I'll be quoting a verse next time. As long as you think joy is out there, you're just going to run round and round. Once you begin to understand that the source of joy is within you, which will enable you to be joyful in relieving distress if there is distress, in sharing joy if there is delight, you found a source of joy. That's why Jesus says, the kingdom of heaven is within. Look at the words, etam disham gandharaha. Hey, that is the path that leads to gandhara. And etam disham vraja. Don't just go round and round screaming. Start moving. Start walking. So, the blind man whose blindfold has been removed, he is a great disciple. Carries out instructions perfectly. And he becomes panditaha. He knows the way. Knows every foot of the way, because that's what will enable him later on to lead his children. Similarly, acharyavan, a man or woman who is devoted to the teacher, who follows instruction very carefully, very enthusiastically, acharyavan, purusho veda, whether it is man or woman, tasya tavat eva chiram yavan navimochi gradually he will get home. She will reach the goal. There is no favoritism in all this. There is no hit and miss. Patanjali says, whoever keeps traveling in the right direction will get home. It doesn't matter whether you're American or Indian, whether you've committed mystics, it doesn't matter at all. And the father ends, Atha Sampachyati. As a man from Gandhara, blindfolded, led away and left in a lonely place, turns to the east and west and north and south and shouts, I'm left here and cannot see, until one removes his blindfold. That's what the teacher does and says, there lies Gandhara, follow that path. And thus informed, able to see for himself, the meditator travels under his own steam, under her own power. And thus informed, able to see for himself, the man inquired from village to village. Asked Victor how to go to Point Reyes. The man inquired from village to village, asked Alan where to turn towards San Anselmo. And finally reaches his home at last. Says, there's nothing to be surprised at, nothing to be amazed at here. The map, the teacher has the map, has give full instructions, will tell you where the dangers are, where you can rest, just where you put on speed, where watch for falling rocks. It's just like that. And reaches his home at last. Just so, my son, one who finds an illumined teacher attains to spiritual wisdom in the self. And there is nothing that does not come from God. Of everything, He is the inmost self. He is the truth. He is the Self-Supreme. You are that, Shvetaketu. You are that.